account or behind account, do not smoke cigarettes. It may be a very explosive experience. No, it's a joke. So, selling a body of trees, which country?
Indonesia.
Malaysia and?
Indonesia.
Who owns the estates in Indonesia?
Malaysia.
Estates are Singaporean. Then you have burning of fossil fuels. So, that in a nutshell is your sources of man-made greenhouse effect. 65% comes from burning of fossil fuels. How many of you drove? Am I the only one? No. Okay. So, give them a round of applause for reducing carbon dioxide. This is the north part of the world, south part of the world. This is in US. This was in Kota Tinggi. I like the picture in Kota Tinggi because Kota Tinggi tak cukup tinggi. This was in 2007. Was this an indication of climate change? Maybe, maybe not. But in Malacca, the Malacca Central was under 1 meter of water. The chief minister of Malacca at the time actually asked why is our bus depot underwater. Actually, it was no secret that our bus depot in Malacca was actually built in the swamp. And if you build in a swamp, it is a swamp because water goes to the swamp, isn't it? So which intelligent fellow would have told the chief minister to build a bus depot in a swamp? Now, a bigger scale of that happened in Thailand. 2010, a whole whole industrial estate in Thailand went underwater because it was actually built in peat swamp. Then when the dams couldn't take the water anymore, they had to start releasing water from the dam. And then Toyota suddenly lost 10,000 jobs. Companies had to shut down, their workers had no work. Why? They were so intelligent, they built factories in low-lying areas where they know water is going to come. But this is what happened in Kelantan last year. Okay. Was it because of the rain? Partially, yes. The Kelantan River has monitors. And the sensors are supposed to say when the water has risen to a certain level. I have a colleague working in the Global Environmental Center. The sensors could not work because it was not water rising, it was mud. So by the time people realized that the mud was already coming to their houses, too late. No time to evacuate. So you have situation of mud water reaching to the second floor of houses. You have cars being pushed off the roads. And basically whatever you have in your first story of your house, if you live on a double story, everything had to be thrown out. There was nothing to salvage. So, I'm going to talk a bit about what is civil society in Malaysia, stewardship and relation, pre-Rio, Rio and post-Rio, because I think especially the younger people have to understand why we have a civil society which reacts the way it does today. What is the Malaysian Climate Change Group or the NC-CDM? Malaysia's civil society engagement in forming climate politics and a little bit more sensitive. What is civil society? It is an aggregate of non-governmental organizations and institutions that manifest interests and wills of citizens. Very, very basic. The individuals and organizations in society which are independent of the government, and this is very important. When a person says they are from an NGO, it's non-governmental organization. We in CETDEM, when we introduce ourselves as an NGO, person comes up, so you get your money from government. The word is non-governmental organization. Okay? Do you get your money from the government? No. We don't get our money from the government. So even as NGOs, there are different kinds of species of NGOs, I would say. You have ENGOs, the environmental NGOs. You have YONGOs, which are youth NGOs. you have bingos, sounds like a game, but these are business interests and NGO. Then you have religious and faith-based organizations. And if you are not aware, there's such a thing called a gongo. A gongo is a government organized NGO. This is a Freudian slip. It's a paradox. A government organized NGO. And this is proliferating in developing countries, and they are not part of civil society per se. So if you go to Cambodia, or you go to Laos or Vietnam, they will introduce themselves as, oh, I'm an NGO. Where? Oh, you're an NGO. Are you working part-time, full-time? Oh, I'm only a volunteer here. I work full-time for the Ministry of Agriculture. They are working full-time for the Ministry of Agriculture, and then they are volunteering for an NGO which is paid for by either a foreign government or the money is channeled through their government. So, do they qualify to call themselves an NGO? For us, especially environmental NGOs, no.
Would this be similar to the ones in Vietnam?
Yeah,
like quite a number of them.
You'll find quite a number of them in Vietnam, Cambodia. I bet one guy in Cambodia who said that, hey, we are not getting a lot of money, you know. We don't know what to do with the money. Anyway, from Malaysia and Indonesia looking at them, they're not getting money, eh? We want to do stuff. They're getting too much money, they don't know what to do. So what they do? They travel. And add to cover downside in this. So, the environmental NGOs in Malaysia, the Malaysian Nature Society is the oldest. Then you have Environmental Protection Society in Malaysia, the CETDEM. Of course, we have WWF, Global Environmental Center. We have umbrella bodies. The Malaysian Climate Change Group is an umbrella body. Mangoes is an umbrella body, although now Mangoes is actually registered. It's registered as an NGO. Yongos, for example, Bolivia provide a clip. Right? Correct, huh? Yes, there's nobody above 55 there, isn't it? Okay. Bigos, you have the Malaysian Employers Federation. Federation of Malaysian Manufacturers and the Business Council of Sustainability and Responsibility Malaysia. You have religious-based NGOs or faith-based NGOs. Malaysian Consultative Council of Buddhism, Christianity, Hinduism, Sikhism, and Taoism. The acronym already is very long. NCCBCHST. Okay. Then you have the Christian, the CFM, the CPHM, Christians for Peace and Harmony Malaysia, and you have other gongos. If you look at anything with a one in front of it, and they call themselves a NGO, one Azam, they do a lot of work in Bodim, especially I think in Sarawak. They help out the Bumiputra and indigenous people there. But they are not an NGO per se, because their funding totally comes from the government. So stewardship. Our friends from the Muslim faith, you understand the meaning of Khalifa? Okay. Khalifa? Padangana. Have you heard of the term Khalifa? No. Okay. For those of the Christian, Buddhist, Hindu faith, the word steward or trustee is something which should make sense. Because we are all trustees of the earth. We are all Khalifa of the earth. To be a good steward means you must be responsible for other people's property and ensure their well-being without cheating, by being respectful, managing, and taking on the property. The steward is not the owner. This is very important. The steward is not the owner. The steward is only a manager. The steward must be trustworthy and not misuse his authority. So in Malaysia, who is the chief steward? I'm not talking about Asia or any other. Our chief steward in Malaysia is actually the Prime Minister, because the wealth of the rest of this country is held in trust by the government. We, if you pay tax, then probably it's your parents. Your parents and people who pay tax are the actual owners of the wealth. So if you think about it, the government is actually just a trustee, which means the trustee can be changed, can be kept in their position by the people who own the property. A little bit of political understanding. And volition means personal political will. So when you talk about people who have made a stand and say, enough is enough. It can be enough is enough in terms of political understanding or in terms of environmental understanding. So values-based decision making, doing what is right, not what is popular, standing up to be counted, universal needs of all persons. So, no mistakes. He was born in India, went to South Africa, became a lawyer, got arrested, thrown in jail, came out of South Africa, went back to India, continued to work on civil rights, thrown in jail so many times until the prison guards knew him well enough. This is your room. India gained independence, and then what they did to him, a Hindu guy went up to him and shot him, and he died. Who is he? Nelson Mandela. He was with the African National Congress. They tried him and then they threw him in prison for 26 years. What happened after he came out? He became president of South Africa. He just recently died at the age of 90 plus. Who is this? I showed this picture to a group of 75 students from my Sunday school and they said Merdeka. Which was not wrong. Papa to Merdeka. What happened to him? 1969, you had the racial riots and then he was forced to transfer the Prime Ministership of Malaysia from himself to Tunku Abdul Razak. And he died a very bitter man. Because whatever he built in terms of racial integration, slowly started to be eroded. Then, who is
it?
If you see a photograph of Mother Teresa when she was very young, you would never expect her to become a nun. She was a very, very beautiful girl. But she had that calling, and the thing is, she went to the convent, and one day she was walking along the road and she heard sound coming from a drain. This was in Calcutta. She looked in the drain, there was a man in the drain. Helped the man out and cleaned him up because he was like a dog already. He didn't look human. And she cleaned him up and then he said, thank you, now I can die. And he died with dignity as a human being. He didn't die as a dog. So if people say that, there was a BBC documentary that said, Mother Teresa did it for her own faith. Now, would you in your right mind, every day, go look for people who are dying on the street, bring them to your house and clean them up because you want faith? Something was not right with the guy who made the BBC documentary. So, all these people have one thing in common. They didn't do what was the popular thing. The chairman of the board of CETDEM, Mr. Engineer Gurmit Singh, he was also the founder, president of the Environmental Protection Society Malaysia, ESM. This photograph of him on his bicycle was taken in the 1980s. And he actually had a competition with a minister going to Lake Garden. And the minister went in a car. He cycled with a gas mask. You know those German movies, the whole gas mask? He had a filter on. But in fact, he actually reached the point the same time that the minister reached with his car. He took out a gas mask and he showed people how the filter looked. It was black. And that was just to prove the fact that even in the 80s, our air condition was already that bad. So this is to give you a background of what it means to be politically sometimes incorrect. To get things done is being politically correct may not be the obvious thing. Being politically incorrect may be the obvious thing. So pre-Rio, how many of you were born before 1971? I'm looking at Adrian, he's purposely not looking at me. So 1971 was when the government of Malaysia came up with the Universities and Universities College Act. So those of anybody from public university here? Okay. This is the reason why you are not allowed to have political parties in your university. Or you're not even allowed to have political activities in the university. Guess who was the reason for this? Anwar, Yusra Hitam, they were all those people from that era, okay? So in the 1960s, they were having fun in university. So because of the Universities and Universities Colleges Act 1971, you have restrictions on student activism within campuses. But that has been amended to allow for a little bit of freedom, but it is still very, very restrictive. 1979 was the first World Climate Conference that was held in Geneva and sponsored by the World Meteorological Organization. It led the creation of the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, or IPCC, by the World Meteorological Organization and the United Nations Environmental Program, and that was in 1988. The IPCC first assessment report came out in 1990. The work actually began in 1985, so it took them 5 years to complete it. And that itself became the basis for the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change. The second climate conference was held in 1990 and again was held in 1990. Something else happened before Rio. There's this thing called Operasi Lalang. How many of you are aware of what is Operasi Lalang? It's important to know. Operasi Lalang happened on the 27th of October 1987. And at that time, the word sustainability was a dirty word. Because social activism, anyone who talked about sustainability was equated to be a terrorist. Social activists deemed as anti-establishment and anti-development. So there were arrests of prominent political leaders, social activists and others. There were even lecturers from UPM being arrested. UM arrested, if I'm not wrong. My chairman was, I think, at the bottom part of the list. So by the time they arrested 100 over activists, they said that enough already last 2 years. Okay. So this was Malaysia 1987. If you were part of a vocal NGO, chances are you would be arrested at IASA. The Brundtland Commission happened also in 1987, and it defined or it gave a definition of sustainable development that was used worldwide. Sustainable development is development that fulfills the current needs without compromising the ability of future generations fulfill their own needs. Basically, what you have today, you need for the next generation after that, and after that. Then we came to the Rio Earth Summit 1992. Why is this important for Malaysia and Malaysian NGO activism? Rio Earth Summit 1992 changed the perception of Malaysia's then Prime Minister, the Honorable Tun Dr. Mahathir Mohamad. Before, NGO activists were terrorists. After Rio, there was a different sense of what sustainable development was about. People who said you must do sustainable development were no longer tree huggers. were no longer people who promoted living on trees. The government now actually understood that people in the environmental NGOs were looking at, if we don't protect the resources that we have today, what are we going to hand over to our children and grandchildren? Nothing. So, it was seen as a direction to be taken by developing countries, and civil society needed to be engaged and not arrested. And during the Rio summit, the Rio Declaration on Environment and Development was established, Agenda 21. Have you heard of local Agenda 21? Do you know what local Agenda 21 is about? Yes. Good. Clap, Okay, so forest principles. Two agreements open for signing convention on biodiversity, CBD, and UNFCCC. Post Rio, in Malaysia, the Business Council on Sustainable Development Malaysia was established. Today is known as Business Council on Sustainability and Responsibility Malaysia. The climate change, Malaysian climate change group, comprising of three environmental NGOs, CETDEM, PSM, and MNS, was established in 1992. And the first conference of parties, COP1, Berlin, took place in 1994. So if you take a look at this slide, you'll see the different meetings and milestones that have taken place as far as climate change is concerned. So from the first summit in 1992 in Rio de Janeiro, and it was followed by the first COP in Berlin, Germany. 1997 was the adoption of the Kyoto Protocol. 2002, Malaysia ratified the Kyoto Protocol. And by the way, the person who did the redrafting of the Kyoto Protocol received the Academy Award in 2007. Al Gore. Is his country one of the countries that signed up to the Kyoto Protocol? Very interesting, eh? He got a Nobel Peace Prize for education on climate change, but his country is still in denial. No, it doesn't happen. 2009, World Climate Conference number 3, Geneva. COP15, Copenhagen. Many people thought that it was Copenhagen, and then after the conference, it became Flopenhagen, because it was a big flop. You know, in 2009, they had 7 climate change conferences around the world. It was Bonn 1, Bonn 2, Bonn 3, then Barcelona, then they had Berlin, and then Bangkok 1, Bangkok 2. So imagine the amount of carbon dioxide being released. Then they had in Cancun, Durban, South Africa, Doha, Qatar. I was in Doha. It's a desert. Qatar is a desert. Malaysia, we use 226 liters of water per person per day. In Qatar, they use 400 liters per person per day. Reason? Free. Nobody pays for water, nobody pays for electricity. We pay now in excess of 2 ringgit per liter. They pay only 85 cents per liter. And anybody who drives a car less than 2,000 cc is poor. 2003 was Warsaw, 2014 Lima. The number of people who went to Lima was, I think, slightly smaller, because if you're from Asia, your total flight time is 24 hours. So it takes one day to go, you stay there for one week, and then one day to come back. Okay? And this year is Paris. Yes.
One question. over here you mentioned like from COP 1 in 1995 till 2009, signing COP 15, like you mentioned earlier, like in 2009 there were a lot of different conferences. Is this where it made up all the different COPs that went?
Well, see, the thing is, if I were to put COP 2 to COP 14, it would be a lot of space. Basically that. Yeah, but every year, this is the main meeting. The one that you have in November, December, like the one that you are planning to go in Paris at the end of this year. COP 13 was in Bali. The number of people who were in COP 13 was so huge. It was incredible. Why? It was Bali. There were people who went there, went for the plenary, disappeared and took off because it was Bali.
I think the question was, it's not 9 different conferences, but those are intersectionals.
Oh, okay.
So they are, COP happens once a year when they adopt their final decision making for the tax at the end of the year. But in between, negotiation still happens. When they want to come up with a decision making year like COP 15, they want to rush things up. So they have extra intersectionals for the year. Usually every year we have about 3 to 4 intersectionals. But for special years they probably have about 5, 6, 7, up to 9. Like this year we're having about 5 intersectionals, 3 in Bonn, 1 in Geneva, and another one in somewhere. Yeah, right.
Thank you. So if you look at this is good for tourism. Okay. I personally call this the climate change circus. It's a circus because when the circus comes to town, everybody gets excited. You know, elephants coming, giraffes coming. So especially if you go to Durban town, you see elephants and giraffes coming. But every year when they name a country that is going to host the climate change negotiations, they are going to host anything between 15,000 to 30,000 people. That's not including spouses who come for shopping. Okay. Coming closer to this thing about policies in Malaysia, I can give you a very, very real example of policy making in Malaysia. It may not be totally related to climate change, but it will give you an understanding of how policies are made. Now this is to show you our energy policy. In 1974, the Petroleum Development Act was created so that now you have Petronas. Before that, anybody want to come and drill, they negotiate with states. Then in 1975, we have the National Petroleum Policy. 1980, National Depletion Policy, which means we cannot pump out more than certain amount of number of barrels of crude oil per day. Then 1990 came the Electricity Supply Act. 1993, the Gas Supply Act. 1994, Electricity Regulations. 1997, Gas Supply Regulation. 2001, Energy Commission Act, which is now why you have the Energy Commission of Suran Jaya Tenaga. 2011, the Renewable Energy Act, and 2000XX Energy Efficiency Act. I put the XX there is because it was supposed to be finalized last year, but then midway, unknown to the rest of us, it suddenly came to a stop. But one of the points that I was brought up is this. When you do energy efficiency, basically you're trying to reduce the amount of energy you're using, but the same amount of output. Now, if you're a factory, you sign a contract with TNB saying that I take a minimum of this amount every month. What happens when you go below that minimum amount? You get fined. So, if you get fined for being energy efficient, does it make sense? So, one law up here has to be changed. So when you start changing one law, it will affect another law or another act. So we went back to the drawing board and we have to now review how many different acts have to be changed so that you can enforce energy efficiency. So you have so many energy related acts, but in Malaysia, do we have a national energy policy? And when we talk about energy, you're talking about what? Electricity, gas, petroleum, right? Your cars and whatnot. Do we have that? No. Does Malaysia have a national automotive policy? We have, because we want to promote our national car. Does it have a national transportation policy? No. That's why suddenly, yesterday I think, oh, Penang now has a master plan for trams. During the, or before the, after the Japanese occupation, there were trams in Penang. They took off the trams and put buses. So what was a bad idea in the 1950s suddenly become a good idea in the year 2015. So where's the planning? Where's the long-term planning? Indeed, policies which are long-term, not policies that are short-term and only for short-term gain. So, CETDEM's policy-related work, in terms of a national transportation policy, there is no transportation policy but the national car policy. We have had transport ministers that act as if vehicles run on air. Seriously, when we ask them, hey, your ministry not sending anybody for the national climate change discussion? No, not related words. Excuse me, 65% of our, 30% of our CO2 coming from cars, you know, cars, buses, and whatnot. Not related words. They were in different ministry. Ministry of commercial, you know, commercial vehicle and licensing. Nothing to do with us. They were entrepreneur ministry. Memo on Comprehensive Malaysian Energy Policy 2007. I was there when this was presented to the then Minister of Energy. We have had band aid policies like what I showed you before. Petroleum depletion, fossil fuel, fifth fuel, alternative energy. It is supply driven instead of demand driven. Now what is the difference between a supply driven and demand driven policy? A demand-driven policy means you look at what is total demand and then you calculate what is the buffer you need. A supply-driven policy is you create as many power stations as possible and then see, oh, more than enough. Okay. So what happened in the 1990s is our buffer was 40%. Any right-minded country, buffer was 15 to 20% enough. So we were having a situation where we were burning fuel to create electricity. Electricity doesn't come naturally unless you want to use your TV using lighting. So electricity has to be generated, and by over generating, what do you happen? You have oversupply. So who makes money? The fellow who put up the power station. And there were power stations that had very sweet deals. I will pay you for your capacity. I don't even have to pay you for what you sell. So if a power station decided, okay, your capacity now is more than enough, you have more than enough electricity, I don't burn, but you still pay me. So the climate change action plan was actually devised in 2004 by NC-CDM and CETDEM taking the lead. It was submitted to NRE, but lost in transit because it entered a filing box and then they decided to shift the ministry building and nobody took note that the plan was in the box. So in 2007, our chairman cornered the Secretary General of the Ministry, at that time Datuk Subo, and asked him, where is our plan? What plan? I gave your ministry in 2007, until today for 3 years, we haven't had a discussion. Oh yes sir, can you send the plan back to me? So it was discussed just before Bali. Barely 1 month before COP13, we discussed a national climate change action plan. And eventually it became the input for the national climate policy, but by that time in 2008-2009, many of the recommendations were already implemented.
So it's the last point, many recommendations were already implemented. So that's a good thing, right?
No, the thing is, it was implemented without looking at it.
By the government?
Yeah. Because, see, when you recommend something, it's ahead of time. Okay? So you recommend it, people look at it, oh yeah, this is a good idea, let's do it. But what happened is, I didn't see your plan, but things happened. We had to do countermeasure, and then the countermeasure happened to be the plan that you suggested 2 years ago. So, in doing that, whoever didn't see the plan wasted 2 years looking for countermeasures that were already there. Does that answer your question?
Yes, thank you.
So, when we talk about policies, this unfortunately is a reality here. So, civil society's view of policies and the government's view of policy. Civil society policy should be civil society driven. We have a climate change action plan. Please read and then we can work together. Government's view, policy must be government initiated. You got plan, I put in a box, never mind. 3 years later we'll do something about it. Policy document should be public owned. You should know what is in the plan. Policy document is government owned. How many of you have read the Malaysian climate change policy? How many of you intend to go to Petaling? Nobody wants to go to Petaling. Okay, the important thing is if you are looking at the climate change issue, first, go and download the National Climate Change Plan, read it and understand it. And try and see where there are gaps which need to be addressed. You can download it from the ministry's website, Kementerian Sumber Asli dan NRE. What your answer you gave earlier about LA21? Yeah. NGOs like it to be bottom-up approach. We come up with ideas and slowly it goes up. The government is a top-down approach. I know best, I push down to you. Okay? Citizens advise the government, government knows best. Policy should be worded in simple layman language. Policy will be worded in legal terms in London. Okay. We were having a quick look at the policy on Friday. Yeah. And Mitchell was asking me, is there any way it says you put this policy and teach people in school? It doesn't say specifically teach in school, isn't it?
Yeah.
But what it says is there shall be formal and informal education. What is formal education?
School.
Is there actually any kind of curriculum for climate change in schools today?
The science?
No.
Very small option. What has been happening is people like MNS, people like WWF, or even people like CETDEM and GAC. When we go to the school and talk, hey, do you have a club like Cipta Alam? Then we approach them and talk to them. That's our audience as far as awareness is concerned. But when you go to university level and you go and there's a particular school of environmental sciences, yes, they have climate change courses and whatnot. But to be fair, private colleges and universities in particular, say for example you have tourism in Taylor's. There will be one particular topic on tourism and climate change. I know that because Taylor students will come to CETDEM and ask for interview with me. So it does happen in tertiary level, but secondary and primary level, big question. Yeah? Result of consultation should be circulated to stakeholders for review. Result of consultation need not be circulated to stakeholders for review. So for example, today, I asked all of you of your opinion for my presentation. From your perspective as a stakeholder, you want to know what was the overall, out of 10, was it 3, was it 5, was it 8? From me as a government representative, for example, I don't care what you say, I just look at it, oh, actually everybody marked me 1 out of 10. Okay. You don't know what happened, I know what happened, but it doesn't matter to me. So this is how policy relationship between NGO and government. Next is action plan first, policy later. So, from the Malaysian Climate Change Group, we come on action plan first. You need to do this. Then only we talk about policy. We come up with policy first. We spend 3 years talking about it. And then after we come up with all the policy, then only we implement action plan. We show you the facts. Government side, we show you the projections. So if you go to government agency like NARIB, National Hydrological Research Institute in Malaysia, they will show you projections of coastline variations from 2020, 2030, 2050, 2100. My question is, how many of us will be around in 2100? Does that projection affect you? I brought a group of Vietnamese to NARIM and they laughed at them. They said in Vietnam we got a joke. Anybody who does show projection above 2050, we laugh at them. You are alive. Nobody, none of us will be alive at them. So, coming back to the climate change policy, CETDEM submitted the climate change action plan to the NRA in 2004. Action plan misplaced. Climate change action plan tabled at National Steering Committee just before COP13 Bali. Draft of national policy on climate change was prepared by Lestari UKM, distributed and discussed with Malaysian environmental NGOs and UKM on the 23rd of July 2019. Guess what? We were called. And we were not given the draft. The draft was only shown to us when we arrived. Now, wait, what policy are you here? Oh, this draft only. The Malaysian environmental NGOs then organized an emergency 2-day workshop to process the draft policy at Malaysian Nature Society on the 15th and 16th of August. So we had to act fast because that draft was already going to go out. Then the climate change policy retreat was held at Town Garden on the 24th and 25th September 2018. So can you imagine? Draft policy shown on July and retreat done in September. Nothing was given in between. So we had to come up with our own program and do a 2-day workshop so that people who are not familiar with the climate change topic could be brought up to speed. And the climate change policy workshop was held at the Marriott Putrajaya on the 7th of July 2009. This is a screenshot of the National Policy on Climate Change. It was approved by the Cabinet on the 20th of November 2009. Such an important policy that it was launched by the then Deputy Prime Minister on 30th August 2010. Approved November 2009, so important it was only released 10 months later. This release was not specifically for the climate change policy. They happened to have a water discussion. And then they had a post recession press conference, and that is when the Deputy Prime Minister launched this important policy. And it was not taken up by, it was not front page, So the policy statement is to ensure climate resilient development to fulfill national aspirations for sustainability. There are 5 principles, 10 strategic thrusts, and 43 key actions. So I strongly suggest that you get a copy, whether it's a soft copy or otherwise, look through it, understand our country's stand on what climate change is about. Anthony, any questions to your previous slide?
So, studying at a timeline, July 2008, August 2008, what is the best practices to do it? Now, this is definitely a rush job, but if given a best case scenario,
if you were to speak with government officers who have been in government for a long time, policy takes anything between 5 to 10 years to implement. You cannot rush a policy over a period of 3 years. Which is why this policy is one thing, the latest policy on even nuclear energy is being rushed. There's no reason to rush into that kind of a policy until there are no more options. And that was the stand taken by the previous president of PND. We will look at nuclear energy as a last resort. When there's no other resort left, then only we'll look at nuclear power. But people are pushing for nuclear medicine.
And could you share with us what happened during the emergency workshop? You know, yes, were you guys given a deadline to feedback or what? Can you walk us through the process after you were given the draft?
We basically look at the draft from page 1 to page 10. We felt that the draft needed to have a preamble. If you look at even the United Nations Declaration on Human Rights, there's a preamble to the declaration. So we suggested that a preamble be put in. There was no definitive timeline. It was as soon as you can, which is why we rushed to get the meeting among the MANGU members at that time. Those who were interested, and in particular, the MANGO members who were already part of the Malaysian Climate Change Group, we became the key organizations in giving the workshops over the 2 days. It was a 1.5 day workshop. And it was through, actually, by no fault of the government, all the environmental NGOs got very quick education of climate change. It was not just the 4 or 5 NGOs that were doing climate change work. All the others also got very fast educated, a quick run of education of climate change. The thing is, here to here, the people who were giving the workshop here ended up going for this retreat. Okay? So if I'm not wrong, aside from Engineer Gurmit Singh, MNS and GEC also, I think, were heavily involved, and also the blood method. So, climate change policy workshop, this, by the time this was done, there were all kinds of stakeholders involved. So, not only environmental NGOs, there were people from transport, groups, other civil society groups. So when it came to that point, one of the recommendations that we asked to put into the policy is please give money to NGOs. Because it goes back to this. NGOs will show you the facts. The government will show you projections.
sorry, another question related to the previous slide.
Yep.
Between 2004 and 2007, did CETDEM continuously engage with NRA, or was it just you had other things to do and then in 2007 you called
on? Put it this way, like, it took 3 years to call on even the Secretary General, KSU, at the time of Dr. Sundari. He's no longer the KSU, I'm sure. So he was very busy. It's not of importance. Until suddenly, wait, 2007, Bali, everybody is making statements, you know. We got to do something.
So it was the COP 13 that prompted them to send anything to
start.
Yeah. And was the climate change action plan that set them prepared taken into account by the study when they governed the
government? To be very honest with you, very much so. Like I said, feedback never come back.
But in the final policy that is now published, how much of the action plan do you see inside?
To be honest with you, we do not know. It would be actually spending time to look at one policy compared to something else that was already developed, and we don't have the resources. But I can, as what Adrian had asked, I will share with you the climate change action plan. Those are very action oriented. Do this. Whereas if you look at the national climate change policy, it is recommended for this. How you do it, if you look at even the action trust, is also very, we can use the word kapo. It is left to your imagination how you can do it.
I think to add on it, back in 2004, we still do not have digital cameras or smartphones yet. That was the era. And it is very forward thinking of CETDEM to even produce and submit a climate change action plan. As we can see, observe this year as well, 2015 is Paris, year of COP21, and between COP15 Copenhagen and COP21 Paris, nobody have heard of anything in between. You know, we need events like this, like Bali, Copenhagen, and Paris, to remind our civil society, our civil servants, and our governments to hey, hello, climate change, okay, no. We do need events like this.
But if you look back at what happened in Durban,
yeah,
Durban was the COP in which loss and damage first became, if I can use the term, an issue, and then from there came up the EDP, advancing the Durban plan. Okay. So when it came to Doha, the Americans were actually, okay, loss and damage. Who cares, loss and damage? Katrina came and went everywhere. And then Sandy hit during the conference. And loss and damage suddenly from very low priority became high priority. Why? The American auto industry was going through a revival. Because there were about 1 million cars underwater. Certainly loss and damage became important. American insurance companies were going to have to pay out a hell of a lot of cash. And if they don't pass that risk over to their partners over in Europe, they have to pay it. Loss and damage became important and is still very important. So the thing with climate change negotiations changes with the weather and the climate. It's a pun, it's a joke, but it's reality. So the climate change group was formed in 1992. CETDEM, EPSM and MNS are the founding members, and the Perak Consumer Association joined in August 2002. WRF in July 2009 and Global Environmental Center in 2012. So, we are brown because we look at urban issues. They are somewhat green niche brown because they also look at urban issues, green and slightly blue because they also look at water issues, sleeping partner, green blue and green blue. We all have specific areas of concern. So NC-CDM, it's not a registered organization, but it is not haram. Okay. Second hosted by PSM 1994, then CETDEM took over. In 2002, NC-CDM launched a 3-year public awareness project now. This was in 2002, and a mobilizing Malaysians on climate change project was done. CETDEM as coordinator secretariat administered the project. WWF is the current host. Now, what is this project about? Now, we're talking about 2002 to 2007. When did Elmore started showing his PowerPoint slides? 2006-ish. So you had two gentlemen, Gurmit Singh, and now the late Chow Kok Kee, who was the Director General of the Meteorological Department. Two of them were going to the country, telling laptop, asking for projectors, showing slides. This is climate change. Like this. They didn't have NASA pictures to show, so nobody was interested. To enhance the ability to address climate change issues in various sectors, energy, land, resource, forests, both at national and international level, objectives motivate as many sectors of Malaysian society, including the business and industrial community, as well as the general public, to take positive action on climate change issues. Get more Malaysian NGOs mobilized. To educate public in all sectors, such as government, private sector, NGOs, school children. With the support of Danset, that was involved in Gudanina, NC-CDM, which is actively engaged in domestic international negotiations concerning climate change, completed project MMCC in May 2005. So, the climate change action plan actually came from this. It was the feedback received from stakeholders. So, briefings for elected representatives of state and federal levels, Penang, Sarawak, and even in Parliament. So, climate change issues, as far as the federal government is concerned, also is not. It was already highlighted by even a person in government, the late Chow Kok Kee. He brought it up, but even as you can see, our lawmakers were not interested. Sarawak, at least 1/3 of the state assembly attended. Penang, most of the elected representatives attended. So, I now go back to NGOs show the facts. Okay. So, as far as the Environmental Protection Society is concerned, they embarked on the LA21. Now, LA21 today in Malaysia is still alive because of the work done by EPSN. And in particular, a very, very feisty old lady by the name of Datin McCoy. So, Adrian, have you met Datin McCoy before? She is one skinny bean lady who can move mountains. But she is the one who basically twisted the arms of the government. We put in LA21 into our local government sectors. In 2007 May, public forum on Malaysia's response to climate change. Now, by this time, Elmore became very famous for doing PowerPoint. So, Engineer Gurmit and Chow Kok Kee went to the British Council. And guess what? Standing room only. Now everybody wanted to know what is climate change. Standing room only. Before, 10 people, 15 people. This was 100, sitting for 100. And there were lawyers standing around trying to find out what is climate change. National workshop on introducing concept of ecological footprint. A national conference on public forum in 2007. 2009, Earth Power, World Environment Day, became a project partner of Green Line, and it's going on. And 2013-2014, Sustainable Living Institutions. MNS, those familiar with MNS know MNS does a lot of work with food. Now, since then, we started off with one project called Demonstration Documentation Center. Those of you who would like to visit our office, you can arrange through Adrian and Mitchell. The house does not have air conditioning, but the temperature in the house is 3 degrees lower than the next office. Passive heat reduction, public briefings, briefing on demonstration pool house, and from this project, the comprehensive national energy policy was submitted. We have already had 5 ministers. None of them have called for a proper meeting. So, in terms of energy efficiency projects, we've had one in 2004, 2005, 2006 is when I joined CETDEM. And had this project with 50 families in PJ, and because of that, we know how much of electricity is being used for particular equipment in the house. We did a project with school children in 2008 to 2010, promoting renewable energy and energy efficiency with CETA Malaysia, and this month we're starting another project with CETA Malaysia on renewable energy and energy efficiency. In transport, we had now 3 projects. One project is ongoing in which Mitchell is the officer, creating people-centric, eco-mobility recreational park in PJ. So, if you go to Taman Jaya, there's a park next to Taman Jaya LRT station. That's the park we are working on. Climate change related, over the last 9 years, we've had 8 climate change related seminars. We've had 3 energy related conferences. And we operated the first organic farm in Malaysia with teaching facilities. I have to use that as a caveat. And we did a project between June 2008 to November 2009. And from that project, we found that 40% of your garbage is organic in nature. So if you do the separation, which the National Solid Waste Management Act says you must do, you should actually separate about half of your garbage, which is organic, and half which is inorganic. That act has been pending for more than 7 years. This is the joke. It's called an egg. Nobody eggs. We've been having Hari Organic since 2009, and we've also been organizing exhibitions. So this is one of the results that we got from our study in PJ. 75% of energy is in fuel. About 20% electricity, and the balance is in kitchen gas. So the energy being used by the ordinary person in PJ, most of it is actually lying outside of their door. Your air conditioning and fans, 44%, refrigeration, 31.5%, so that's cooling down. Cooking and heating, and this heating is not cooking and it's not boiling your water for drinking. Guess what it's for? Shower. What's the temperature outside? Low 30s. Right? Low 30s, 32, 33 degrees. 11% of our electricity goes towards heating our water. So, aircon room, hot shower, aircon kitchen, aircon car, go to aircon office, aircon gym, come back to aircon house, go to take hot shower, aircon room with electric blanket. Only 7% on lighting, which is why for CETDEM, anybody say, oh, we must change all the lighting in the building. I would recommend that you walk around with a bulb. If you were to control just increasing your temperature from 20 to 22, you will probably reduce this by 10%. That 10% is probably half of your lighting usage. So, why should I walk around with the block? Does this look familiar? I hope your car is not there. Does it look familiar? Okay, I showed this to people from Philippines. They actually claim this is in Manila, although they don't see the wajah and all that. This is in USG in front of Summit. Now, nothing to do with policy, but this is something important to understand. The usage of 1 kilowatt hour of electricity means emission of 1 kilogram carbon dioxide equivalent at the electricity power station. It varies from year to year. In Peninsular Malaysia, it's about 0.55. In Peninsular Malaysia, 0.65. Sarawak is 0.55. In Sabah is 0.75 or 0.8. Reason being, in Sabah, they use a lot of diesel generators. Which is why when they wanted to put up a coal-fired power station, I personally agree. Because the coal-fired power station is cleaner than the diesel-fired power station. But people were fighting against the coal-fired power station. So they are still living with a very dirty power station. Combustion of 1 liter of diesel petrol means the emission of 2.5 kilograms of carbon dioxide equivalent into the atmosphere. Do you know what is the largest car park in Malaysia between 7 and 9 in the morning and 4 and 6 in the evening? The Jungle Highway. You've heard of the term rush hour? People can move on. Cannot. So, you imagine the poor policeman there standing, trying to take traffic tomorrow, and he's inhaling all the carbon dioxide and other carbon monoxide, nitrous oxide. So, the study that we had in PJ involved 50 families. The CETDEM, we are based in SH2, PJ, Hospital Park. Always promoting sustainable development. The word always is there because we cannot do it part time. Providing practical and sustainable solutions. Now, some solutions are practical but not sustainable. Some solutions are sustainable but not practical. Okay? But we promote both because if we have done it, then we suggest that other people follow. And we've been doing that since 1985, so this year is our 30th anniversary. We are not for profit. We do training, research, expertise, and development. Our areas of concern are climate change, energy, transport, organic farming, and management. We have our own think tank called Sustainable Development Initiatives. We chose that because the acronym in Malay is SUDI. SUDI ka anda menolong. Okay. We had the first study, lowering the heat. Second study, inclusive urban sustainability. And we have a third study which is pending because nobody wants to give us 220,000. See, government wants the results, but they don't pay.
So who funded the first two studies?
Self-funded with a little bit of help from DG, telecommunications. This was more or less self-funded with a little bit of help from my friends. And this is pending. Right? We've got 3,000 from YBO and 5,000 from one of the engineering group friends. So you see, the thing with NGOs is, where do you get money from? If we tell you we get our money from donation, now donation also is a dangerous word to use. So now we must say we get money from the offering. So people who are interested in helping the environment, when we say we need 220,000 to do it, a lot. Huh? But we want to give the report back to you so that you can take action. How are you going to save your water resources? or in this term, how sustainable are our cities? We wanted originally four cities: Georgetown, Petaling Jaya, Malacca, and Kuantan. Reason being, two Pakatan Rakyat, two Barisan Nasional. Kuantan, nobody want to give any information. Malacca, Georgetown gave information eventually. MPPJ gave us the information because we worked with them on so many projects. Even that also not complete. So if you want to do sustainability studies, we need baseline data. If the municipalities and cities are not having baseline data to begin with, how do you judge in the next 10 years they are sustainable? No way. So we did a start. So now it is up to the cities to continue. This is our website. For those of you who are follow Tun Mahathir, we did not cheat it. You set them. Not cheat it. It's pronounced CETDEM, CETDEM.com. And this is our Facebook. So as you prepare for COP21, this was COP13. Didn't you went? COP13 was in Poland. Actually, the number of people who went to Poland dropped because nobody wants to go there in the winter. And if you want to go to Poland, some of them stay in Germany because it's cheaper. So in Poland, you have the executive director of the UNFCCC. You have one of the ADK, Advancing the Development Platform Project. You notice that people are very nicely dressed, you know, nice air-conditioned room and all that, and they're talking about climate change. And then you look at it. This is the reality. They can talk till the cows die or so. These are people suffering. Where is this? Philippines, after Hayan. 2012, I was there, the Filipino representative cried in the General Assembly. People dying here. This one, he cried again, you know why? He just got off the phone from his brother. His brother was picking up dead people because their kampong kena. Cried again. Last year, he was barred from going into the going with the Filipino delegation. So he cried too much. Yeah. They were embarrassed. They were embarrassed to have him around already. Because it showed that nothing changed. People still go there. If this was America, everything would have changed. Unfortunately, Filipinos, Southeast Asians, and non-Americans, this is life. We are expendable. We are expendable. Unfortunately, in the world view, we are expendable. Until and unless something rocks the US, then the US will suffer. Until and unless another Sandy hits the East Coast, where their financial centers are, then only the change. But at the same time, there are not only rich people in the US and Europe. There are lots of homeless people in the US and Europe. But there are a lot of rich people in Malaysia who live the lifestyles of people in the developed countries. So, if you want to make a change there, can you try and make a change people living in Montkiara, people living in Putra Heights, and kawasan-kawasan yang semacam dengan dia? Because that makes a big difference. So, any question?
Okay, I'm just curious, since
Malaysia
is CETDEM have done a lot of seminar and conferences before. What is the main outcome of those? Yeah. And how does it help in policy making?
Our climate change seminars basically is to preach to those who are not visible. That means to preach to people or to share climate change with people to do more. Okay? That is our aim. But unfortunately, most of the people who come for climate change seminar is like singing to the choir. Everybody on the same page, almost everybody is on the same page. And we go there to seek consolation that, okay, like, our work still is relevant. It's a sad reality. It is a sad reality. When we had the climate change on clean development mechanism, and CDM is one of the processes that you can make money out of it, we had lots of people coming because they all wanted to know how can I make money. But when now we start talking about water, last year we had something like 24 people coming. This year we have 50 people coming. So water is becoming a big issue. People don't look at it as a climate change issue per se. But if the next Coca-Cola company was to come into Selangor and the state government says yes, and the Langat 2 is not built, then can you survive with water only once every 3 days? Because there will be a reality. And that's what we want the people who come for our seminars to know. Hey, if you don't make changes now, by the time it hits you, it's too late. It's one thing to look at the bus 1 kilometer away, it's another thing to look at the bus 3 feet away. And it's still running at 60 kilometers an hour. So the challenge, and you can ask Mitchell, the challenge of getting people to come for an awareness program. Not even a paid conference, an awareness program. It's so difficult to get the commitment to say, yes, I will listen to you. Because I think you have a message which is interesting or important. So, very often it's like, I don't know whether you know the Beatles, the man on the hill like, talking to himself, singing and all that. And nobody wants to bother because he's mad. He's trying to save the world. So you are now joining the ranks of the insane. Seriously. If you speak to people who are doing work, and Adrian has already been committed to a few institutions, I think. Yeah. You talk to people from WWF or people from MNS, BSF. We all know that we are fighting a losing battle. At the same time, the encouragement is we will never get retrenched because there's always an issue there. People will continue to throw rubbish into the river, into the drain. People will continue to pollute the air and whatnot. Our job will never finish. And there will always be a new batch of people to retain. So, yes, we try to reach out to those who can make a difference, but ultimately it's up to them. We cannot force them to come for our events. But there are changes, I would say, especially in terms of at state level and also at local government level. The Selangor State Government has been supporting us in our climate change activities over the past years in terms of small grant when we run a particular seminar, so that at least we know that partial funding is already there. In terms of the local government, MPPJ is supportive in our current project. We are doing the awareness talks and meetings and whatnot. They are providing the infrastructure. They are doing the actual work on the ground in terms of changes. It's slow. Sometimes working with government is like the CEO of WWF uses this term, herding cats. Have you tried to get 10 cats to run in the same direction? One fellow will run there, one fellow will stand there. They'll look at you and, yeah, so what? It's herding cats to go in one direction. But when they actually run in one direction, it's hard to stop them. But the key is getting everybody on the same page and going in the same direction. Any other question?
So, when you look at this level of organized by the government, So what do you think we as civil society should be, how we expect to influence their policy?
Do you come from individually, do you come from groups? Do you have groups of friends?
Yes.
Yeah? You have group of friends. How many of your friends know what climate change you know? Some of them say, well, cut up. The thing is, simple question, do you know the difference between weather and climate? What's the difference? How many of people out there, even the newscaster can say, masalah perubahan cuaca ini telah berlanjutkan bertahun-tahun. Even people in the news industry don't know the difference between climate change and weather change. What else the common Joe and Abad and Abdullah on the street? Cannot. We have to engage people on it. If you have friends in your university circle or your job, even friends in your, whether you're working, engage them and get them to understand, hey, climate change is not just hot sun. Climate change is more than that. You cannot beat climate change by carrying an umbrella when you walk. It's more than that. If you see your neighbor nicely washing the car with a hose there, 3 times a day, there are people who get their maids to wash their car 3 times a day because they are afraid the maid, you've got nothing to do, the maid will go and talk to the meter reader. And then something else will happen.
Yeah.
Or, okay, maid nothing to do, iron all the t-shirts. Again. Because for them, electricity is cheap. But do you know that what electricity price you're paying in the recent day, you cannot have that in the Philippines? Filipinos, those who live in the Makati area or just outside of Manila, are very rich. They cannot run all the 10 aircons at the same time. They can run only one aircon one time. Reason is, one unit there is double the price here and the electricity there is not consistent. So if two influence on aircon, everybody you try and leave your aircon running in Singapore. When you start paying the cost, when you start calculating the cost, it's very good. Here, we had one visitor from an embassy. When we showed on one of our videos, we showed the bill was something like 90 ringgit. Is that your normal bill? I said, why? No, my bill is about 600. Ah, what do you do in your house? Oh, I leave the aircon on all the while because I don't want my bread to get hard.
What?
I leave my aircon on 24 hours a day because I don't want my bread to get hard. The bread cost is 2 ringgit. Aircon cost is probably about 400 ringgit. Don't mind because my embassy is paying for me. So how many of you, my parents paying the electricity bill, is not important for me to see what's the meter running. My children, I tell them, if our bill is works out to be more than 10 units a day, something is wrong. So I calculated how much should the refrigerator consume, our TV, our entertainment unit, our lights, okay, all supposed to come to about 8.5. If you want to use an aircon, you can use it for that month. So if I sit on 275, okay, 275 units, 300 units, something's wrong with it. Maybe somebody's been using it. And we have only one aircon unit now. How many of you have seen people drive 100 meters to buy newspaper and come back because it's too hot to walk outside? So you want to make a change, you have to start making changes first and make a change. Set them, if we travel outside the office during office hours, if it is Lone Ranger, you take the bus and you take the LRT. Or for me, I drive to the nearest LRT station. Park here is the issue there, 3 ringgit, and then take your leave KL. Do you know that you can go to KL, do your business, whatever work you want in KL, and come back faster than driving there and coming back? You're looking for car park time is longer. And then looking for your car after that is even longer. If you don't take a picture, I take a picture of my car against the nearest pillar so I can find my car easily after that. Because whenever I go to Big Valley, I don't know where my car is. Next question.
Is there any hope of having an agreement here?
Adrian will still have a job in the next 10 years. Whether he is still considered used in 10 years' time is another problem. The thing is, whenever we talk about the climate change negotiations, we are negotiating figures. And we are negotiating promises. And those promises can only be banked in by year 2025, 2030. Somebody's got to monitor every year whether you are actually keeping to your promise or not. Who's going to, what, they're going to start a war if you don't keep the promise? Or they're going to come out one, okay, because you did not reach your target, we issue you a fine. That was supposed to be the original negotiation under the Kyoto Protocol. If you cannot reach, you have to pay. But today, Kyoto Protocol also, the second commitment period is uncommitted. Because of that, the clean development mechanism died. What used to be 30 US dollars or 30 euro per metric ton of carbon dioxide is 50 cents. Nobody wants to go into the project because it's not worthwhile already. So almost all CDM projects are already dead. So they're converting that to now what they call NAMAs, nationally appropriate mitigation actions. And in the NAMA actually has a relevance in Malay because the whole point of NAMA is to dapat NAMA only. You don't get any cash. All you get is bragging rights. Oh, we are going to do this. You haven't done it, you know. We are going to do this, therefore I can say we are going to do this. So, I don't want to give you a totally black picture about what's happening. But when you compare what started off in the first COP, from even the Earth Summit in 1992, till what is happening today, the pressure from civil society upon the government is getting stronger and stronger. The next election in the US, anybody who has the stupidity of saying climate change doesn't exist because we haven't got a complete science anymore, is going to lose. Because everybody knows climate has already changed. So that kind of mentality doesn't hold any more water at all. So even if you look at the oil and gas industry giants, they are also now looking into, I might as well go and buy a renewable energy company now. Prices are still low. Petroleum price has dropped like crazy. I cannot get dividend. So it will eventually be business driven. So it goes back to that cartoon I showed you earlier. What if we do all this? We get a better world, and it's for nothing, because climate change may be wrong. Wouldn't you want to live in a world where you can breathe in clean air, drink clean water, and not have to pay for the processing? You go to China, they had to stop vehicles from going into Beijing for 1 year, so that the trees can turn from green to green. Do you want to have that in Kuala Lumpur in the next 20 years? Or you already have that in Kuala Lumpur? Next question.
In Malaysia, are there any specific actions to mitigate climate change that you know what we need to handle? Whether by NRE or any other industry?
The See, the thing is, when you talk about mitigation actions, for a very long time, the Malaysian government has been looking at mitigation is not what we are supposed to do. We are not an export country. We are still deemed as a developing economy. So therefore, we still have our carbon space to fill up. Yeah? But to be honest, because we have been moving to newer technologies and cleaner technologies, it's an indirect effect of having mitigation efforts. And for example, having the Renewable Energy Development Authority, Sustainable Energy Development Authority, SEDA. Because of SEDA and because it was formed in 2011, the price of PV panels has dropped from as high as 28,000 ringgit per 1 kilowatt peak in 2005 to, if you import from China now, is anything between 3,500 and 4,000. So as long as the technology becomes cheaper, people will invest in it. And the pricing has come to a point where even if a household doesn't get the FIT payment, it makes sense for them to put up. It's already affordable. Okay. In terms of our automotive emissions, the engines today are much, much more efficient and cleaner compared to 2007. There are more Prius, there are more Honda hybrids, there are even BMW hybrids, Camry hybrids. So you're talking about the hybrid technology that's coming into Malaysia has already brought in capability of reducing the amount of CO2 being emitted per passenger kilometer. The more we push into MRT and LRT, actually MRT and LRT are much, much more efficient forms of transport than bus, and definitely more efficient than personal transport. So the government has been doing it, but it's not something that is overtly being done because of energy. But it is being done because it makes sense and it makes also economic sense. I hope that answers.
Yeah. And not green building index is also becoming more fashionable.
Ah, you hit that on the nail. Because it is fashionable. People don't do it because it is the right thing to do. They do it because also bragging rights. My building is green. As far as I'm concerned, you paint your building green, it is green. somebody made a joke about having a nuclear power station. Because people say, nuclear power station green. Yeah, you paint green, it becomes green. Yeah, you had a question?
How do you foresee the relationship of CSO in Malaysia with the government in the coming years, especially in climate change?
Well, that's a tough question to answer now. Okay, the reason is this. In terms of the civil servants is one thing. In terms of their political masters is another. In 2007, the minister was Asmi Khalid, and he was overly enthusiastic in announcing to the world that Malaysia is a carbon sink. That means we suck up the carbon and we release. Because he said we've got lots of forest, 60% forested. He did that, if I'm not wrong, he did that against the advice of his civil servant. Because UNDP had conveniently released one report saying that Malaysian carbon emissions had increased by nearly 200%
from year 2000 to 2005. So how do you balance this? One person saying we are sick, another one saying the report from the UN saying we already emitted fires. Then change over to after him was Douglas. So Dato Douglas is from Sarawak, and the thing is most of the time the Ministry of Natural Resources Environment is always under authority. One time he was under health authority. So Dato Douglas is someone who is very sharp and he understands climate change, which was very, very right. So the team that takes care of climate change in Ministry of Natural Resources and Environment, we're very happy that this is one guy. You give him a piece of paper, he reads it, he says, I don't agree because something's wrong with this. Rewrites. And he gets the facts. And he actually throws the facts out. Then he got moved to plantation. Then he get Panrivel. And now, I pass the word to Karan. There's no point talking too much about that situation. So now you have a new minister who, according to people in NRE, is also again very sharp, again from Borneo, and they think that he is one person who can push the agenda. So that is a very positive.
Really?
Yes. Because, like it or not, when Douglas Kuga was the minister, there was a lot of issues. So now, come to the civil servants. The chief secretary of the ministry retired. The Timbalan who was formerly the crib director, Dato Nick, Rahim Nick, retiring. The former Sato Sir Bahagian retired. Because he retired, the people who were under the ministry who couldn't get out, now nobody is to stop running. So one by one start applying to get out of the ministry, because who wants to live out of a suitcase for 6 months in a year? When you're young, it's exciting. When you're already into your 30s, 40s, and then get a stroke in bone, it's no longer fun. Eat too much of healthy food. So now you have a situation where the negotiating team is at its lowest. They have to build up again. So we are really hoping that with the new minister, things will start getting back into shape. Because if for the last 3-4 years, and this year, nothing much to say.
If you mentioned this, like the ministers have nothing much to say and things like that, why aren't the civil societies in Malaysia actually stepping up then and actually taking charge of this instead? Is it something that they're not allowed to do, or is it something that no one has taken the initiative yet?
Well, the process, okay, if you're talking in terms of the UNFCCC process, as far as the negotiation process is concerned, the civil society has a role outside of the conference hall in convincing their country negotiators that this is what they need to do, this is what it's supposed to fight for. But in terms of our actions in the negotiation table, there's nothing to tell you. And even worse in Malaysia's situation, we are often clumped together with groups. We don't negotiate on our own standing. Right? So, I give you an example. We have ASEAN, right? And this year, Malaysia is the chair of ASEAN. And we have ASEAN, people-centric ASEAN. When I was in Doha, Malaysia will sit here next to Egypt. Thailand will be the other side. Indonesia will be there. Philippines will be sitting maybe with island states, we're not too sure. Singapore will sit with island states. Singapore, which has one of the highest GDP in the world, will sit next to Fiji.
Now, civil society wants to make a difference. At any one time, there will be probably 3 or 4 discussions going on. You know what's happening with the Malaysian delegate? He's running through the GAPA because G77 meeting in GAPA. And he knows that because he gets a phone call, where are you now? What? There's a meeting in the GAPA, no? And then by the time he reaches there, okay, G77 and China have already decided that. And then Malaysia decided that, oh, this cannot go on. Too big a group, because G77 started as 77 countries, now it's more than that, and then you get China, the big elephant in the room. The flood comes and everybody flies off. So you got like-minded states. Like-minded states. Egypt, Arab children. Like-minded, then yeah. When you have too many people in the like-minded group also, they become unlike-minded. So one fellow says this, the other fellow is on the other extreme, you cannot come out in the second. So, for civil society, it's quite tough. It's quite tough. Unlike Philippines and Thailand, where civil society actually gets a pink badge, you actually come under government. And Indonesia, some of them actually come under government. Philippines, yes. Thailand, yes. Malaysia, no way. But, when it comes to gathering information, they want to know what you know. The delegation wants to know what you know. What you heard about the Americans, or what you heard about the Canadians, or what you heard about the Australians. Because they know you plus will go and talk to the Australian youth, American youth, and all. They will want to pick your brain to know what the enemy is doing. That was what our chairman used to go through. He go for a call, and he will have to go and tell the delegation, hey, guys, those fellas are not planning this, you know, they all know, no, huh? Quickly go and run and call for me. So, our role is to keep our delegation also up to speed. Hey, you got not enough people going for meetings, we have found out about this. You want to check, them. There was one year, Ken wanted to give a fossil of the day to Malaysia because Malaysia came out with a stupid statement. And finally, Malaysian NGO had to convince them that please take it off. It doesn't serve anybody. So, we have a role, but it's a limited role. As I said, we do our work on the ground here, show the government, hey, climate change, people need to know. We need to do this kind of thing for awareness. So even though we are doing a project on eco-mobility, my talk starts with, what is climate change? Because if you don't have an understanding of what contributes to climate change, you don't see the urgency, you don't see the importance of why you recycle, why you smoke. By the way, how many of you walk? All of your hands should be up. Because you would have walked from your car. Correct? So we often take that for granted. Any other question?
This is Chow Koki. Yes. Talk about Mr. Chow.
The late Mr. Chow. The late Mr. Chow is one of those very vocal government officials. He was known as Chairman Chow because he was the chair of the Clean Development, the CETDEM board. So he was known as Chairman Chow. He was the one who was pushing, actually he was the one who was pushing for CETDEM to be not what it is, or what it is today, but CETDEM to be a central fund, and that fund to be distributed to developing countries, irregardless, so that they can take that money and do clean development, sustainable development in the countries without selling their sovereign rights. Here in Malaysia, most of our CETDEM projects are pump waste. palm oil millers are one of the biggest money makers in Malaysia. Palm oil is a 50 billion ringgit business in Malaysia. They don't want to do what you call recovery from their palm influence, you know why? If other people pay me money better. Even though they can do the project on their own and still make money, they don't. They rather throw their effluents in a pond, let the methane come out. But if one masali company comes and says, oh, we will put a cover and collect your methane and use that to generate electricity to run your mill, I can. Give us a money. So, the idea of CDM has been adulterated. A stronger word actually is it has been bastardized. Because people are not generating unnecessary gases to claim on CDM. And you're not talking about one to one. There's one particular gas is 60,000 times CO2. Which means if they eliminate one ton of that gas, they will be paid 68,000 tons. CO2 equivalent. That's happened in India, that's happened in China. And after some years, then only they stopped. So, Chairman Chow, he passed away, I think, was it 4 years ago? 4 or 5 years ago. When they finally, the chief negotiator at the time, Mr. Chow, he announced during the plenary session that I have very sad news to share that Mr. Chow Kok Kee from Malaysia, formerly known as Chairman Chow, has passed away. The chief of the one of the co-chairs ran out and cried. That was the influence this man had. If I'm not mistaken, it was Christina. She ran out of the conference hall and cried. And poor Gary had to go and no, it's okay. Dr. Gary. So Malaysians actually had a very prominent role in international negotiations for many years. Unfortunately today, our English standard has dropped to a point where they rather get a Thai or Indonesian to speak on their behalf. Seriously, you speak to your Indonesian contemporaries, the English is much better than us. Our education system has forced our status in the world. In the 1960s, 1970s, and even in the 1980s, Malaysians were sought after in any UN conference, not just climate change. They come to Malaysians, why? You speak Queen's English, people can understand you. Your accent is neutral. You don't have Filipino accent, you don't have Thai accent, you don't have Indonesian accent. You have Malaysian accent, which is neutral. Fellow from Australia can understand you, fellow from Germany can understand you. Now we are afraid to speak to Malaysians because our Malaysian delegates, when they go to a conference, you have anything to say? That is a sad thing. Chow Kok Kee, the late Mr. Chow Kok Kee, is someone who can actually control the machine. It's just like Dong Chairman. When he doesn't go for a cop, you'll ask why so quiet. He doesn't go for a can meeting, why quiet? Grouping all around. And everybody who is above 50 years old knows who's grouping. Because he used to be on the can board. And he used to make so much noise until people got fed up. And then, when he's not there, they could be not wrong. So you have to stand your mark. You have to stand your mark. I'm a Malaysian, I have this to say. Why so serious?
Okay, any more
more question?
Yeah, because I'm afraid I might be arrested. So thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Anthony Tan. I hope you guys learned a lot from today's training session. We have put a lot of effort in this, and we welcome donations to support MYD and also our following training sessions. And please follow up with the latest update on MYD through Facebook, Twitter, Instagram. So thank you for attending, and a little contribution is very much appreciated. Thank you very much.
Actually, I thought the donation box was done to me.
I'm very broke today. Coming to
two. No, I got the contents of the donation box.
Okay.
I now remember this moment, Mike. I remember this moment. No, as in when you came this time, I said, hey, since when we got donation box? Then after that, when it came round, it just... I remember this.
Moment.
Okay,
Mr.
Anthony Tan, thank you
so that's the end
you
of this
still
video.
Have the attendance. Where's the attendance?
This Adrian.
You all still have the attendance.
So till next time, everyone.